लेकिन माँ बाप आपको पैसा
ओहो, ठीक है भाई।
ওয়াশিং মেশিন কভার করে দিতে হবে বা দেখুন একটু দিন, একটু দিন দেখুন, কম বাদ দিয়ে কি আর আনছে বিটটা। চা গরম করে মুক্তি দেবি
তাকে দেখুছি, তাকে দেখুছি, তাকে দেখুছি। পলিথিন এটা কল ভেঙে গেছে না লেপু দিলাম, সব কো অলিয়া ডবা ভিতরে দিও তাহলে কোন ডবা।
से ज्यादा वो यहाँ पे ले जाते हैं। দেখো সব কপাল টাকা জারি ভুলে দেখো কিছু জানুনি কিস্তি সারটা কিস্তি জানিনি সব জানছি। হুম 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 ব্যাগটা যদি চার্জ করে সে করা তাহলে নন্দনী কোটা না দি গজেন্দ্র প্রধান।
हेलो हेलो राव सर, हेलो डॉक्टर राव। हाँ
ପ୍ରମୋଦ ସାର୍ କୁହନ୍ତୁ କୁହନ୍ତୁ ସାର୍ ହ୍ୟାଲୋ
ଆମେ ଆଉ 5 ମିନିଟ୍ ପରେ ଆରମ୍ଭ କରିବା,
ହଁ ସାର୍ ହଁ ସାର୍ 6:10 ଆରମ୍ଭ କରିବା ସାର୍
6:10 ଆରମ୍ଭ କରିବା। ଉଦାଉଟ୍ ଏନି ଇଣ୍ଟ୍ରୋଡକ୍ସନ୍ ଆଇ ସାଲ୍ ଷ୍ଟାର୍ଟ ଡାଇରେକ୍ଟ।
ଓକେ
କିଛି
ଭେରି ସର୍ଟ ଭେରି ଭେରି ସର୍ଟ ଭେରି ସର୍ଟ ଇଣ୍ଟ୍ରୋଡକ୍ସନ୍
ନାଇଁ 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 କିଛି ଦରକାର ନାହିଁ। ମୁଁ ଦେବି, ମୁଁ ମୁଁ ମୋ ବିଷୟରେ ଦୀପଦ କହିଦେବି।
ନାଇଁ 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 ଆପଣ ବିଷୟରେ ଆପଣ କହିଲେ ଅସୁବିଧା ନାହିଁ ଆପଣ କୁହନ୍ତୁ ଓକେ
ଓକେ ଓକେ, ଜଷ୍ଟ ଜଷ୍ଟ 1 ମିନିଟ୍।
Namaskar. I have the privilege to welcome everybody to the webinar series on contemporary Indian philosophy. Today we have Professor Pramod Kumar Das and Dr. Basant Kumar Das to speak on the philosophy of Swami Vivekananda. I welcome both of you, sirs. Today, Dr. Pragya Paramita Das Kanungo will moderate the interaction session. Welcome, Madam. Sri Sachikant Babu and Sri Devasis Sadangi will record today's event. Welcome both of you. I also welcome all the coordinators of philosophy family. I'm happy to see Professor Saroj Mahanti sir with us. Welcome to you, sir. Thank you for your participation. The biggest welcome goes to all the participants in today's event, without whose active support to philosophy family, there would be no existence for the family. I wish more and more participation in the webinars conducted by philosophy family. In the first session, we have Professor Pramod Kumar Das, who will be speaking on practical Vedanta and universal religion of Swami Vivekananda. Before he starts his lecture, it is a formality of this platform to introduce the speaker, though Pramod Das needs no introduction, and also he doesn't want any introduction, but it's a formality we have to maintain. As we know, Professor Das is the founder of this philosophy family group. All the activities, including the webinars, are conducted as per his guidance. The coordinators just take on the activities that are directed by Professor Das. He is the speaker today. As we all know, Professor Pramod Das is a good academician and is also much known for his clarity in expression of thought. He is a thinker who thinks with lot of energy and lot of depth, and most of the time I feel he keeps on thinking on issues. And he takes the blessings of late Professor Hrudananda Rai as his guiding force. He is presently the president of Chinmaya Mission Puri, and also he is the chairman of the Wisdom Intellectual Forum, Puri and Nayagarh. He conducts seminars in these forums on a regular basis. We are fortunate to have him today. He will be addressing on practical Vedanta and universal religion of Swami Vivekananda. Without wasting much time, may I request Professor Das to address the participants of this webinar in the philosophy family group. Thank you. Over to Professor Pramod Das for the lecture.
Namaskar to all of you. Sir, am I audible, sir?
Ha, you are audible, very much audible.
You
are audible. You are audible, audible.
Yes, sir, yes. Respected Dr. K.M. Narayan Rao, sir, coordinator of this session. Respected Dr. Pragya Priyadarshini Das, madam. My dear Devasis. Respected my revered teacher, Professor Dr. Saroj Kumar Mahanti sir, I am very fortunate that he is with us in this session. I feel nervous. How to start and how, where to end? But teacher's blessings are always with us. So I believe when a student speaks, he speaks through his teachers. Respected all the participants and my dear students who are attending this webinar. Today we have a very beautiful topic, practical Vedanta and universal religion. Actually, this topic is very vast, but I shall try to highlight the main points in a very short time. What is Vedanta? Then what is practical Vedanta? Then what is religion? And then what is universal religion? These four things we shall discuss. The fundamental teaching of Vedanta is that reality is one. To discover the unity in all the diversities. That is the highest knowledge. This fundamental teaching has been interpreted differently by different philosophers in different times. Contemporary Indian philosophers have also interpreted Vedanta in their own ways, keeping in view the practical necessity of the modern man, the modern situation. Vivekananda, Swami Vivekananda, Sri Aurobindo, Radhakrishna, and many others have interpreted Vedanta in their own ways. And they have focused on the present scenario, the present society, the present living style of human beings. So that is the uniqueness of contemporary Indian philosophy, that it is not just a copy of the traditional philosophy. In contemporary Indian philosophers have not just copied, have just followed the philosophy of the ancient philosophers. They have their own views. Shankara says that Brahman is the ultimate truth and everything that except Brahman, that is appearance. Anything without Brahman, suppose we say the world, anything that appears to us, that is appearance. And behind everything, there is only one ultimate principle, which is called Brahman. Brahman is a name. Our principle is the principle of unity. That unity is named as Brahman, named as Atman, named as God. But what is the principle? The principle is that there is unity in the diversities, and that unity is the only truth according to Advaita Vedanta. and the diversity is the appearance, is the falsity. Diversities are false. They are appearances. To this, Vivekananda varies. Vivekananda says that the unity is real, the diversities are also real. Unity is real and diversities are also real. Here we shall come to the notion of cause and effect. How this can be explained? Vedanta says, Advaita Vedanta, cause and effect are one. The effect is the appearance of the cause. There is no duality between cause and effect. Only the cause is real. Because there cannot be duality in any form, even not in causal relation. The material cause and efficient cause of something are same one. From and by, from which something is created and by which something is created. For example,
सर आपण स्टक हेगले सर आपण करो हेलो 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 कैन एनीबडी प्लीज रेस्पोंड इज प्रमोद दास सर कंटिन्यूइंग हिज लेक्चर वी स्टक
नो सर
नो 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 वी स्टक वी स्टक ओके 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 ओके
Sir, what happens? Sir, what happens?
Sir, अपन stock है के लिए, stock है के लिए अपन आउटर लॉगिन करो.
Okay, okay, हाँ okay, yes.
क्या है?
वहाँ lecture चल रहा.
Huh, we'll be joining soon. Please, please, please bear with us. He's joining soon.
Hello.
Sir, you are audible now. Audible, audible.
Audible, sir. Audible.
You said that material cause and the efficient cause are one. Till that we have heard you. Okay, then you continue, sir.
Yes. I was speaking about an example that is clay and a pot. clay and a pot. The material cause is clay and the efficient cause is the potter. So in Naya system, when we talk about Asat Karjabhata, there we believe that there are three types of causes: material cause, efficient cause, and non-inherent cause. That means something out of which something is created. Somebody or the agent who creates something, and the process of creation. These three things are there. But in Vedanta, the material cause and the efficient cause are one. From Brahman, Brahman is a name. Brahman, from something, from that, out of which everything has been created, and by that, everything has been created. So here, the material cause and efficient cause are one. How can we understand this? For that, we have to, for this 40 minutes or 45 minutes, we have to go to the sea beach, and I invite all of you to our Puri sea beach. Imagine that you are sitting in Puri sea beach. There are crowd around you. Children are playing with sand. They are making houses. Different sellers are selling their products. Many people are talking, gossiping, merrymaking. And in the sea, there are waves coming and down, rolling, coming, and also going back. What more we can see? We can see that behind the waves and with all the noises, crowd around us, behind the violent waves, there is a silent ocean or silent sea. Nobody observes that. When they have gone to sea beach for merrymaking, suppose a philosopher is sitting there. A philosopher will see that, yes, behind the violent waves, there is the silent sea. Now the question is, from where these waves come out? From the ocean, from the sea, and by the sea. Here the ocean is the material cause out of which the waves have been created. And the ocean is the efficient cause which causes the waves. Waves are not caused by the sky. Waves are not caused by the beach or by anything else except that ocean. And between the silent ocean and us, there are violent waves. This is our position. Between the unity and the person who will realize that unity, there comes diversities, violent waves. You cannot reach that silent ocean without crossing the violent waves. In order to reach there, you have to understand, you have to accept the diversities, the violent waves. Now the question is whether these waves are real or illusion. This is the question. Shankara says, these waves are illusion. These waves are appearance. Vivekananda says, these waves are real. In the course of my deliberation, always feel that we are sitting in the sea beach. I shall start here and I shall end my speech in that sea beach. All the examples I shall take from that sea beach, that ocean, the relation between ocean and waves. Can you deny that the silent ocean is false? No. It exists. Can we deny that these waves are false? No. They also exist. Can we deny that we, the perceiver, the person who is discussing all these things, who is noticing all these things, who is realizing all these things, is false? No. Everything is real. They have their rules, they have their function, they have their force. Waves have their force. There are three types of people. Some who understand, some people are there, they understand that the only the silent ocean is real. The waves are false. Some people understand that the waves are real. Waves are real. And the ocean is false. And some people understand that both the ocean and the waves are real. So in order to understand that both the oceans and waves are real, we have to go beyond. We have to go beyond these two. If you only understand that the ocean is real and the waves are false, the unity is true and the diversities are false, you are limited. You are limited. You cannot cope with this practical world. You cannot live in this practical world. If you only think that only the waves are real and there is no background, there is no foundational reality behind it, behind the waves, then also you are limited, you are ignorant. Therefore, Vivekananda says that both the ocean and waves are real. Because the waves are nothing but the ocean in another form. The form of the wave and the form of the silent ocean, the form of the violent waves and the form of the silent ocean are two forms. And we have to understand that these are two forms. Not that one is true and the other is false. Because, why not? Because the waves have come from that ocean. In this Kartika Purnami, 5 days or 7 days before, I had gone to sea beach and I saw that there are no waves. Sometimes we see that waves do not occur. There are no waves. There is plain water. There I saw now the deep ocean, the silent ocean, has suspended its diversities. You cannot do, I cannot do, no science cannot do that. When I saw that there are no waves, the water is very clean and silent, as like the ocean, there are no waves. So that is the unmanifest state. Sometimes that happens. We see the sea without waves. So whether the sea is with waves or without waves, that is the only manifestation of that sea only, that ocean only. We have to understand this. We have to understand this. Now come to the second point. Waves are not only real, they have certain forms and they have force and they have presence, occurrence, and even if you do not know, suppose you are a silent observer, you are watching both waves and the violent waves and the silent ocean, that's all right. Suppose you want to swim, suppose you want to take a bath in sea, how can you bath if you do not know the rule of the waves? The waves are so violent that they can kill you. When the waves take this shape, there occurs a wall before you, wall of water. I have bathed, I have that experience. Therefore, I am telling that how to bath in sea. Suppose I know, I have knowledge about the silent ocean. I do not have any knowledge about the violent waves. Can I bath? If I shall dare, then I shall be killed, by injured. Therefore, many people do not bath. They only see and enjoy. How to bath in the sea, confronting the violent waves? We have to accept. Suppose somebody will say, no, I shall wait. When all the waves will subside, there will be no waves, I shall bath. Is it possible? No. Waves will come. That is practical, that is necessary, that is natural, and we have to accept it. We have to accept the diversities. We have to accept the contradictions. We have to accept the pluralities. Not only that, we have to know the skill how to deal with the diversities. When the violent wave take this shape like a wall, one should not behave like an innocent diver. That I shall approach the wave, I shall just go near the wave, then the wave will kill you, will can make you, can hurt you, can break your bones. Therefore, one has to dive through the walls, because behind the big wall of water, there is the silent ocean. If you do not dive through that wall of water, that wave, then the wave will kill you, may injure you. So you have to jump. You have to jump, you have to dive through the wall, and you will cross the wave, and the wave will come to the beach, and you will float on the silent water. This is the technique of taking bath in the sea source. It is very easy to take bath in a river, in pond. But whenever we are bathing in the sea beach and there are violent waves, we have to know the technique, how to dive through the waves so that we can... Suppose you dived through the wave and you crossed the wave, then another waves will come. Other waves will come and the first wave will return. When the first wave which you have crossed will return, it will take you into the sea by the current. So in that fraction of a moment, you have to take a decision that if I shall not reach the beach by the help of another wave which is coming next to it, then we will go into the sea and you will die. Suppose you dived through the wave, then you have to return to the beach by the force of another wave. Otherwise, the first wave, what you have already crossed, that will pull you into the sea and you will die. If you will face the wave innocently, you will die. Even if you crossed the wave and you do not take the help of a next wave, you will die. So we have to be very careful. So in that sense, the waves are real. We have to accept this reality. As we accept, yes, the silent ocean is real, similarly, we have to accept the diversities are real, because the diversities are nothing but the manifestation of that unity from and by. This philosophy is very much central to many shastras like Sanskrit Bhagavatam. Sanskrit Bhagavatam, the first verse says, Janmadasya jata anyadi taratha, and from that everything has come out. Bhagavatam, the first verse. You take Brahma Sutra, the first line, Janmadasya jata, the same thing, the same message. You speak of Taittiriya Upanishad, there it is written, Yataha ba imani bhutani jayate. From that everything has come out. From, not by. Regarding by, that is a conflict between theist and atheist. Whether this world is created by God or not, that is a debate. But theists cannot deny that something comes out of something, because something cannot come out of nothing. That something may be called God, may be called God particle. Science says God particle, philosophy, our religion says God. We do not name it that. Therefore, I said Brahman is a name, God is a name, Atman is a name. When we claim that by something, by Brahman, this God has been created, there is a debate. There may be a debate. Theists will not admit, no, that is not such agent which has created world. But from that everything has been created. This cannot be, there is no doubt at all. Because ex nihilo, nihilo fit. Everything comes out of something. That something may be scientifically interpreted, may be philosophically interpreted, may be religiously interpreted, but we cannot say that there is nothing out of which something has been created. That is the essence of Vedanta. I have told that Bhagavatam, Sanskrit Bhagavatam says that Brahma Sutra, the opening verse, the opening line, In Katha Upanishad, I have taken one verse. Nitya Nityanam Chetanam Chetananam Ekaha Bahunam Jo Vidhadati Kaman तम आत्मस्तं जे अनुपश्यन्ति धीराहा तेषां शांति शाश्वत शाश्वती न इतरेषां नित्यो नित्यानाम हु इज रियल बियॉन्ड ऑल फॉल्सिटीज हु इज नित्य बियॉन्ड ऑल अनित्य एंड हु इज कॉन्शियस बियॉन्ड ऑल कॉन्शियसनेस from that everything has come out and the person tat atmastam je anupasyati that person that seer who sees the silent ocean through the violent waves is dhira and he is the wise person and that person gets peace That means Vedanta is not a philosophy of escapism, that you have to escape from the waves. You have to escape from the diversities. You have to live through, you have to understand through the diversities. Because the diversities are nothing but the manifestation of that unity. We have to understand this. We have to understand that The unmanifest and the manifest are nothing but two forms. And these two forms are real from different standpoints. Advaita Vedanta also says that there is Paramarthika Satta and there is Vyavaharika Satta. From empirical standpoint, everything is real. Everything is practical and form. And from Paramarthika Satta, it is appearance, it is false. Vivekananda also accepts that. Vivekananda only varies in the point. And not only Vivekananda, all contemporary philosophers, they interpret that this. Don't say that it is illusion. Don't say it is Maya. It is Maya, but Maya not in the sense of illusion. Appearance. Don't explain away. You have to explain the diversity. We do not need to explain away the diversities by claiming that they are appearance. You have this knowledge that deep ocean is the reality from the transcendental point of view, from the Paramarthika Drishti, and the waves have been created by time, space, and causation by these three categories. You have this knowledge, but you have to live with this knowledge. And when you live with this knowledge, you have to accept the diversities. Because the silent ocean is not accessible to us without the violent waves. Whenever we go to sea beach, we confront the waves first. And between the silent ocean and us, there comes the violent waves. This is the nature of creation. This is the nature of world. Suppose vast ocean can be compared with the Atman, Brahman. And I am the seeker. I want to know Brahman. But what are the waves? My body is the wave. My intellect is the wave. My sense organs are waves. My likeness, my dislikeness, my family, my society, the state where I live in. Where I am. By the state. Which rules me, the society where I live in. These are all waves. I have to live through these diversities. I cannot know Brahman. I cannot know Nandini, 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 you mute yourself, Nandini.
Oh, sorry.
This is the message of Abhi Devgan. Now, what is practical Vedanta? If you understand this, that this is silent ocean, and there are violent waves, and I am the seeker to realize both the silent ocean and the violent waves, then what is its application? Then we shall now apply this principle to many things. For example, first we apply this love, bhakti. Formless love, pattern, Professor Jishi Naik Sir was telling about formless love. That was that deep ocean, the silent ocean. And what are these waves? Now these waves are the manifestation of love in different forms, like father, son, daughter, husband, wife, student, teacher. These are all forms of love, where the pure love, the love as such, is manifested. Sat Chit Ananda, we know that is Ananda Swarupa, that is love, that is unmanifest, the love is unmanifest, that is formless, but we have to experience that through the different forms of love. And these forms of love are not different from the unmanifest love. This is an example. This is the application of that ocean and the waves. Similarly, suppose we take karma. We shall apply this principle in karma. If we are doing something in the sense of a duty, suppose you are doing niskama karma, then that can be comparable with the deep ocean. That karma, niskama karma, in the sense of a duty. So there are different forms of a manifestation, that I am doing the duty of a teacher, duty of a student, duty of a father, duty of a husband, duty of a wife. These are the different forms of my karma. And when forms of a karma are discussed, are interpreted, naturally there will be some expectations, there will be some plan, targets, etc. And they are natural. But behind these intentions, expectations, we should have the knowledge that I am doing everything in the sense of duty, that I have no kamana. I have kamana in the sense of waves, but I have no kamana in the sense of a deep ocean. Similarly, we can apply this principle in case of a religion. Now we can understand what is the status of a religion and what is universal religion. Apply this principle. All these varieties of religions that we have, Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, etc., these are waves. And the essence of a religion is that ocean. Then which is real? Whether that essence of religion is real or these forms are real? Both. Vivekananda says both. Because we cannot reach the deep ocean without the waves. These different religions, they have different institutions, and they are different in philosophy, they are different in mythology, they are different in rituals, but their message is one. They propagate the same value. So from the standpoint of the essence of all religions, the religion is just like that deep ocean. We have to understand this. But that does not reject the different forms of religion. Because ocean will be there and waves will be there. And waves are nothing but from that ocean and by that ocean. So we may institutionalize, we may organize, we may have different organizations of religion. We may follow different philosophy, different mythology, different rituals, and we may come under different banners of religion. But we should have that Vedantic sense of unity, that all religions have a common message. Islamism gives the message of a universal brotherhood. Hinduism gives the message of spirituality. Christianity gives the message of self-purification. Even in that sense, we cannot say that this is universal religion, because this is universal philosophy. Vivekananda says the universal philosophy is not universal religion. Universal ritual, suppose the practices are same in all religions, that is not universal religion. Suppose the philosophy is same of all religions, that is not universal religion. Because philosophy, ritual, and mythology, these are the different forms which divide. Then what is universal religion? What is the origin? What is religion according to Vivekananda? Vivekananda says that this awakening of the spirituality, that what is man? Man is not. Man is a body, mind, and spirit complex. The spiritual awakening in man, that means going beyond the limit of our body and our sense organs and intellect, is religion. Any religion that promotes this attitude, that help us uplifting ourselves, transforming ourselves from the limitation of senses and our intellect, and to land in the domain of spirituality, that is religion, and that is the deep ocean that is common to all religions. Spiritual awakening. In diversities, we are engaged with our sense organs and our power of reasoning. Therefore, we sense many things, we understand many things, we interpret many things. But in spirituality, there is complete unity. So religion is that necessity of humanity. Religion is a necessary aspect of human living, because man has to realize his own nature, own essence, that is spirituality. Universal religion means that. Therefore, when Vivekananda said that my brothers and sisters of America, he was appreciated, because he was accepted. Because the voice came from his heart of unity, my brothers and sisters of America. That if I shall say, or you will say, or any layman say, it will have no effect. When sound comes, when language comes, from the deep understanding, from the deep realization, it has an impact. on the cosmos. My sisters and brothers of America. Universal religion means acceptance. Acceptance. We accept the opposite because I am established in the unity. If I am established in the deep ocean, then, and I know that all the waves have come from that ocean, then there is no problem of accepting the waves. If I only understand the waves, different waves, and I have no knowledge about the deep ocean, then religious conflicts will come, social conflict will come, human crisis will come, contradictions will come. Vivekananda says, contradiction is natural. Contradiction is natural because it's the lack of human understanding. Because human beings are engaged in diversities. And that is natural. So one has to understand what are the diversities. One has to understand what is the unity. And one has to understand both unity and diversities. So, the essence of a Vedanta, that everything, whatever we see around us, has come from one source, by that source, if we understand this, if we are established with this principle, then we can apply this principle in bhakti, in karma, in religion, in everything. I am giving you just I shall speak 5 minutes. I am concluding. What is the difference between life and death? Life means attachment to me. I interpret it this way. Life means attachment. Just imagine. And death means detachment. Today my pet dog died. Now his dead body is here. After my dog, I shall take care of that dog. Now he is dead. Life means attachment. When we have life, we have all types of attachment. My son, my father, my mother, my property, my house, my bank balance, my knowledge, my body attachment. And when there is death, everything is lost. There is detachment. Nothing is mine. Nothing is mine. My question is to you, what is the moment of that gap between everything and nothing? Life, attachment, everything, death, these are 2 points. This is life, this is death. Life means attachment, everything. He is attached with everything. This is death, nothing. What is the gap? What is the moment? Where is everything and where is nothing? Where everything is, where, what is that point where everything becomes nothing? No point. Everything is apparent, nothing is apparent, or everything is real, nothing is also real. Everything is nothing. If we can explain the moment of a gap oh, this is everything and this is nothing, then we can separate them. If there is no gap, everything and nothing, then everything is nothing. The unity is diversity. That silent ocean, but or that violent waves are nothing but the silent ocean in disguise. And that silent ocean is nothing but the violent waves in disguise. If we realize this truth, then we can experience our dead body all the time. Yes, I am everything at a point, and I am nobody at another point. Then, as Mahatma Gandhi said, always feel that you are absent. Always feel that you are detached. This is the philosophy. Then what is ethics? Natena tektena bhunjita. With a sense of sacrifice, you enjoy everything. You live with an ideation that you are no more, you are dead. Because there is a possibility of not being. Being, not being. Being and not being are same. Unmanifest and manifest are same. Only our approaches are many. Similarly, there are many religions because there are many approaches to religion. To understand that unity of all, that unity, that essence, that spiritual awakening, we take different forms to understand. Yes, if I am born Hindu and I follow the Hindu rituals, Hindu philosophy, Hindu mythology, but that does not mean that I am aligned to, I am different from, or I do not have any respect for other religions, because I am a wave only. And that is another wave, that is another wave, that is another wave, and all waves are waves from and by that deep ocean. So universal religion means we should open our gate for all religions, because we have to understand we are nothing but the waves of that deep ocean. Ocean will lap, will waves will qual. Jadi dheu mane kali karibe samudra hasiba. ଦେଖ ମୋଠୁ ଜନ୍ମ ହେଇ ମୋ ଆଗରେ କଳି କରୁଛନ୍ତି, ଝଗଡ଼ା କରୁଛନ୍ତି, ଆରେ ୟୁ ଆର୍ ଫଲ୍ସ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଅଲ୍ସୋ ଫଲ୍ସ। ଏଇଟା ବି ମିଛ, ଏଇଟା ବି ମିଛ, ସେଇଟା ବି ମିଛ, ସେଇଟା ବି ମିଛ। ଫିଲୋସଫିକାଲି ହାଉ କ୍ୟାନ୍ ୱି ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡ ଦିସ୍। ଇଫ୍ ୱି ଶାଲ୍ ଟ୍ରାନ୍ସଫର୍ମ ଆୱାର୍ ସେଲ୍ଫ to a higher ladder of consciousness, we can understand the diversities that are understood in the lower level of consciousness are of different status. The higher we go into our deeper level of consciousness, our understanding, our realization of that deep ocean will be better. Better, better, better. But the problem is that here Vivekananda follows Gautam Buddha. The problem is that suppose you became a man of wisdom, suppose you became a liberated person, suppose you became enlightened, suppose you understood deep ocean, don't stay there. You come to the world of diversities, you come to the world of a common man and enlighten them also. So many seers also who are established in unity, they forget diversities. They think that our job is over. That is not the way. Practical Vedanta means by understanding the unity, you have to know the art of living in diversities. If by crossing the diversities, you reach the level of unity, then you forget the diversities, then you are limited, you are one-sided. And you are useless also, you are useless. You have no use, you have no practical value for the society, for the humanity. Religion gives us that understanding, that realization. With this, because time is very short, I have to stop here. There are many things to say. I minimized my thought. I spoke very precisely. And I shall stop here. Thank you. Thank you. Now over to Rao sir.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Pramod Das, for your nice lecture. Having a very clear understanding of the practical Vedanta and the universal religion. And you gave the lecture by taking all of us to the sea beach at Puri. And the entire lecture that what I saw was on the waves, tides and the ocean. And your entire lecture is based, on the following lines of Swami Vivekananda, I quote, the absolute is that ocean, while you and I and sun and stars and everything else are various waves of that ocean. And what makes the waves different? Only the form. And that form is time, space and cognition, all entirely dependent on the wave, unquote. So these are the lines that inspired you, and this is the gist. Okay, and you have taken these lines so seriously that you managed so nicely. Okay, your talk on practical Vedanta and also the universal religion. Okay, so your comparison of the various religions as the tides of the ocean, okay, all forgetting about the ocean. So that makes that brings in conflicts in religion. So very good message that you have given. So the problem with religions is they have forgotten that they are the tides of the ocean. The ocean is laughing. Oh, very good message to all of us. And the best part of your lecture lies in towards the conclusion, where you said, understand the ocean and don't remain there. Come back to the level of tides and waves. Spread the message of the ocean and make everybody understand about the ocean. So that's the great message that you have given to all of us in the philosophy family. We are greatly thankful to you for your very nice lecture. And it's a beautiful lecture, I say, because you have not, say, directly touched practical Vedanta and universal religion, but you have tried to solve many issues by taking two, three lines of Swami Vivekananda and try to explain not just practical Vedanta and universal religion and different concepts in our life. So we can apply whatever you have said in different walks of life and make both the appearances, the so-called appearances from the standpoint of Vedanta as much real, that uplift us to know the reality behind. Okay, so both are real, the waves are real, the tides are real, and also the ocean at the background is real. So we have to understand this. Very nice and very lucid lecture by you. Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Pragya Das Kanungo to take on the questions in the chat box and put the question before the speaker so that he can answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. Good evening to everyone. I pay obeisance to all the senior members of philosophy family, and my best wishes to the younger ones, especially our dear students. My profound gratitude to the speaker of the first session, Professor Pramod Kumar Dash, who is also the founder of philosophy family, and who is widely known for his dedication and commitment to philosophy. His untiring efforts have made us stay connected to each other during this pandemic period, and have made a number of webinars happen in a short period of time. Another thing I must say that he delivers his talks, the way he delivers his talks is greatly admired by others. He makes the most difficult notions of philosophy comprehensible to the young minds. He coordinates seminars, is a speaker in various sessions, drafts letters of appreciation, summing up the lectures, and that too in an excellent manner, and the list goes on. I'm really glad that I've been given the responsibility of conducting the Q&A session for him. But I don't find any question in the chat box. I think the participants want to unmute themselves and ask questions.
There is one question in the chat box. Just take it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, there is one question. I am reading.
Yes, yes, one question that came just now. There is a question from Ambika Prasad. He says, "Can an atheist follow universal religion?"
With a big yes, 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 big yes. We have many examples. Gautam Buddha, Jinnah, these are all atheists. Universal religion can be followed by both theists and atheists. Yes.
Well, another question which is not complete actually, that is from Ranjita Muduli. The world is a creation of, and she has not completed the question actually.
She wants the blank to be completed by the speaker. Maybe. He wants the blank to be completed.
The world is a.
He wants
the by blank the speaker.
To be completed with the.
Okay. She has written, "The world is a creation of." Sir, you have to complete the sentence.
The world is a creation of.
She hasn't completed.
What is a creation of dash?
I think she wants you to complete.
You have to fill in the blank.
This world has been created from and by that unity. I have told it repeatedly. This, according to Vedanta, this world has been created from and by that unity. That unity, we may call it Brahma, we may call it God, we may call it Atman, we may name anything like that. If we say God or Brahma, then atheists will argue with me. So from something, by something, this world has been created. In Vedanta, it is said it is Brahman. Hello.
Yes, sir. There are no more questions. I request the participants to ask questions if they want.
Okay, if there is no more question, then we shall proceed to the second session.
I have a question. My question is regarding Swami Vivekananda's notion of practical Vedanta. It's called practical as he wants the Vedantic ideals to be realized in practical life, to bring about social equality and oneness. But to me, it's quite idealistic, which talks about an unattainable goal. What's your take on this?
Please repeat it. I could not get you.
Okay. I repeat it. My question is regarding Swami Vivekananda's notion of practical Vedanta. It's called practical because he wants the Vedantic ideas to be realized in practical life, to bring about social equality and oneness. But to me, it's quite idealistic, which talks about an unattainable goal. I think it's not possible as long as there are different religions that he calls institutional religions, different races, different kinds of people with different kinds of views. What is your take on this?
Yes. We have to accept our existential position. We have to accept. Suppose we shall speculate something, then that will become idealistic. We have to accept our existential position. Suppose I am born poor, you are born rich. I am born of my father is a layman and your father is a big man. There are many differences are there. But we have to accept that and we have to go ahead because all these diversities are false. In the course of evolution, situation change. What you think today that will differ tomorrow. That will be changed to tomorrow. So within the diversities, we have to go to understand, to reach at the point of unity. That is the point. Because we have to understand both unity and diversity. If we understand that, then we can think of social equality. We can think of economic equality. In order to have social equality, in order to have economic equality, where from shall we start? We shall start from the present position, present status. Automatically one day we shall get that goal. So that is very optimistic remark of Vivekananda. There is no doubt.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, if there is no question more, then
no
we shall
questions.
We shall go to the second session. In the second session, we have with us Dr. Basant Kumar Das with a very beautiful topic, Man and God. So we shall listen to him. Okay, thank you. Thank you, everybody, for your patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pragya Daskanungo, for moderating this first session. In the second session, we have Dr. Basant Kumar Das, who will be speaking on Swami Vivekananda's conception of man and God. Before he starts his lecture, may I have a few lines on him, on his achievements. Dr. Das joined the Orissa Education Service in 1981, and he got retired from Ramadevi University, Bhubaneswar, in 2018. He has authored three books, edited three books, co-authored one book, and published about 30 articles in different journals. He has organized 5 state and national level seminars, and he is recently awarded a doctoral degree by North Odisha University for his work on the study of Swami Vivekananda's ideas of universal religion. Okay, so we'll be really benefited because he has worked for his research work on Swami Vivekananda. So we'll be learning a lot from him. As a last line, though he is retired, but he is not tired of the academic activities. So let us now invite Dr. Basant Kumar Das to deliver his lecture on man and God in the philosophy of Swami Vivekananda. Over to Dr. Basant Kumar Das.
थैंक यू
नाउ इट इज टू लेट आई थिंक एंड आई विल स्टिक टू माय टाइम एट द वेरी आउटसेट आई एक्सटेंड माय हार्टी वेलकम टू ऑल माय प्रणाम टू माय टीचर प्रोफेसर सरोज महांती and all my friends, students, participants, those who are here in this webinar. And especially I also be thankful to this philosophy family, the organizers, Pramoda Abu, Kalas Abu, Rao Abu, Patita Bhavan Abu, Pragya, and others, those who are directly or indirectly they are being related to this. And I will go to my topic straight. And you have already listened to Professor Pramod Babu, who has delivered his talk on the core aspect of Vivekananda's philosophy, that is known as the universal religion and practical Vedanta. And he has started his philosophy, his deliberation, taking you all to that of your sewage. And that is the simile which Vivekananda has given. That is to understand how these absolute and the particulars, they're related. And with that simile, he has tried to elaborately explain all the concepts of Vivekananda, including that of God and man, which have been assigned to me. So therefore, my task has been very clear and easy. And therefore, I will focus on these two points. I will start with God first, then I'll go to man. That will better for understanding. And in this regard, I will try to give, because these are all concepts everybody knows, and that is also being discussed by Professor Das. So that's why I've decided to give certain original sayings of Swamiji so that you can understand in a better way. Here, let us start with the topic God. What is the concept of God? And as already I have told you, that for him, God and Absolute, they are one and same. Already that has been discussed. And these two concepts most often are therefore being taken separately, differently, because one is a metaphysical concept, other is known as the religious concept. But he has taken both as same. So therefore, God and man, they are therefore, God and reality, they are not therefore different for him. And in this regard, I just remind you all that he was the spiritual disciple of Ramakrishna. And Ramakrishna is a great Vedantist. And therefore, as a follower of Ramakrishna, he is also a great Vedantist, who has therefore spread the Vedantic philosophy throughout the world. And you know, everybody is being aware of it, that his address in the World Parliament of Religion in the year 1893, particularly he highlighted on these two concepts, universal religion and practical Vedanta. And that therefore brought glory to India, directly or indirectly, that making India known throughout the world, and because of this universal religion, or that is Hindu religion, say to say, or Sanatan Dharma, we can say. And before going to discuss on these two topics, that is man and God, or God and man, let me just give a little bit introduction, that you know that Vivekananda, particularly on the opinion that Vedanta has saved India from materialism twice. That particularly during the 6th century BC, when there is a chaos in the religious atmosphere or the social atmosphere, you can find, because of the domination of caste, creed, like this. At that time, Buddha came. And Buddha, therefore, particularly saved the society by giving the emphasis on particularly the ethical aspect of Vedanta. And you know, therefore, no caste, everybody is one, all the things have the ethical aspect of Vedanta, and that is for the first time he could save Vedanta from the catastrophe. Secondly, that during 9th century, you know very well, when Shankara came, that was also a period of turmoil. When Shankara came also, he tried to give it a definite interpretation, particularly taking the intellectual aspect into account, and you know that also saved our Vedanta. In that sense, Vedanta also saved our country, particularly India and other places, particularly from this materialistic growth approach. And it's also, you know very well, particularly during 19th century, when India was witnessing turmoil in the religious and social order, and at that particular juncture of time, Ramakrishna Vivekananda appeared and gave a practical approach to Vedantic philosophy. As you know, practical Vedanta, the practical approach to Vedanta, and tried to bridge between the Eastern spiritualism and with that of the Western materialism. This is the most important thing which has been done by, particularly by Vivekananda, and that is the most important aspect in practical Vedanta. That is bridging between this Western and Eastern, that is spiritualism with materialism. And as an operator, as an Advaitin, he believes in one reality that is known as Brahman, and therefore he is a monist, and also he is a theist because he believes in the personal God, that is therefore the personal God or worshipping God is there, and therefore we can really say that his philosophy can be said both monism as well as also monotheism. And it is because of his the influence of Vedanta in one hand, and that is Vaishnavism on the other hand. That is the thing we know very well. And that he differs from Shankara, already I have discussed by our friend, that is Pramodabhu. His interpretation of Vedanta differs from Shankara or Advaita Vedanta interpretation. Shankara, as you know very well, as a monist, he believes in one reality, that is Brahman, and the world is being taken as unreal, not as a sky flower like this, but something illusory. But here, God concept is also being there, but that God is not real. It is the creation of Maya, and therefore that is not real. But here, as a theist and as a, at the same time also an absolute believing in absolute reality, this Vivekananda, therefore, he has tried to bridge the gap, and therefore he points out that this absolute is also God, and therefore the he differs from Shankara in this respect. We find that, and in this regard, metaphysically describe, you know it. I am not going to discuss all these things because you know everything. That God is before transcendental, he is absolute, he is beyond space and beyond time, and he is one, infinite, absolute, and all these descriptions you know very well. He is not at all a whole, he is one. If you take as a whole, therefore he will become having parts. That is not the case, he is one. He is indescribable, he is indefinable, and therefore our language fails to describe, mind fails to conceive. He is beyond all the differences. He is therefore Vedatita, even also beyond the limit of Swagata Veda, that is known as internal differences. And taking his real nature into account, and he is being described by as Satchidananda or Satchit Ananda. You know it very well. And Ananda, pure existence, pure consciousness, and that is our pure, that is love. Ananda here is being interpreted as love. Love is very vast, and that is very core philosophy of Vivekananda. Vivekananda has given this interpretation of Ananda as love because he has taken love as the core aspect of the reality. And that unity, as Pramodabhu was talking about, that absolute which is nothing but unity in the midst of diversity. Swami Vivekananda has given a human touch or a personal touch to the concept of God, like that of the concept of religion, as you know very well, for him religion is realization of one's own divinity. As I shall discuss, man, there you can see that divinity, that's man is spiritual, that is the core nature of man. And religion therefore enables him just to realize that he is divine being, he is not only confined to this body-mind complex. And that's why here he has given a personal touch of that is human touch, and God therefore is being taken as the supreme being, he is supremely good and loving, and therefore keeps interest in the creation, that is preservation and destruction of the world which is being created by him. Therefore, in our context, you know that he is a Trinity, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, we also believe in it. So he believes that the absolute, or that is God, is both therefore personal as well as also impersonal. It's both. And thus, for him, God is both therefore transcendental as also immanent. He is a transcendental, he is beyond, he is a unity, he is at the same time also personal, or he is therefore immanent in and so all the particulars. And therefore the empirical world, which is the creation of God, that is also real, and he is there in and through all. And as the example Pramoda is giving, and that is also given by Vivekananda also, that is the ocean and the that of the waves. Waves are nothing but the name and forms, and we are therefore confined with this, and therefore fail to realize the true nature of the reality, and therefore we fail. What is the ocean? We do not understand. We only see the waves. And here, in order to understand the true nature of reality, we have to understand both that is immanent as well as also transcendent. And therefore, I may quote Vivekananda, see God in everything, in life and death, in happiness and misery. The Lord is equally present. The whole world is full of the Lord. Open your eyes and see him. This is what the Vedanta teaches. This is what the Vedanta teaches. See the oneness. That is the whole, the core teaching of Vedanta. That is the practical Vedanta. That is also universal religion. The realization of oneness. That is the unity. And Vivekananda was influenced by his spiritual teacher. I already have told you that who also believes both in personal and impersonal reality, that is God. Ramakrishna therefore used to say, I quote, I believe in my God the wicked, my God the miserable, my God the poor of all races. That means God therefore is everywhere. He is there in each and everything, and even in all the individuals of different differences. Similarly also he points out, it is God who manifests himself in the atheist and the believers, or the theists, the good and bad, the real and unreal, that it is he who is present in waking and in sleep, and that he is beyond all this. So therefore he is immanent and transcendent. He is within all and also beyond all. This is his conception. And again also he points out, God is with form and without form. Is a form, and without form means is formless also, transcendental. Images and other symbols are just as valid as your attributes. And these attributes are not different from idolatry, but are merely hard and petrified forms of it. This is what Ramakrishna points out. And similarly, also again points out, I should say, fix your mind on the form you appeal to you, that appeal to you must, but know for certain that all forms are the forms of the one God alone. This is therefore his appeal, that whatever you like, you therefore concentrate on it, and by concentrating it, again you can realize that whatever you come across, all the are nothing but the different names and forms of the same reality. And thereby you can also realize the God, that God is both immanent as well as also transcendent. And with different names and forms, God appears to his different worshippers. And that's why again he says, the Lord of the universe, though one manifests himself differently according to the different likings of his worshipper, and each one of these has his own view of God, which he values most. To some, he is a kind master, and he is also devoted friendly to others. This is how his conception of God, and this conception of God also enables him to display the diversity of religions, the coalition among the religions, and again he has also tried to establish the unity between all religions, and which is extended by Vivekananda by explaining the concept of universal religion. The above idea of Ramakrishna is well upholded and explained by Swami Vivekananda in his Vedantic explanation of God. He says that God is in everything, where else shall we go to find him? He is already in every work, in every thought and every feeling. Thus, knowing we must work, this is the only way, there is no other. This is his own language. He also says, through his control the sky expands, through his control the air breathes, through his control the sun shines, and through his control all live. He is the reality in nature, he is the soul of our soul. And again also he points out, the ideal of man is to see God in everything. This is the human beings, we have to realize it. We are only confined ourselves within these diversities, differences, the particulars which come across, and they are only the mere name and forms. They are not only real, but beyond them, that is the reality, the unity, that oneness, that Brahman, that God, that is there. And therefore he points out, the ideal of man is to see God in everything, but if you cannot see him in everything, see him in one thing, in that thing which you like best, and then see him in another. So on you can go. There is infinite life before the soul. Take your time and you will therefore achieve your end. This is how we can realize. This is the means that you fix your mind on one and try to realize it. And then you can therefore become aware that the reality is behind it. It is real and it is behind it also. That is unity, which is therefore nothing but the Brahman or God. That one can therefore realize. That this is explanation of Vivekananda in the same way as it is being explained by his teacher, that is Ramakrishna. Thus we find that he is very sanguine in emphasizing the concept of God. Without faith in him, it is therefore very difficult to live. That is his conception, that we have to live only with a strong faith in God, who is therefore the absolute as in transcendental form, and also he is immanent in the same way. For him, God is the necessary support and the ground of both world and soul. The world, the phenomenal, and soul, which is transcendental. And therefore, they both are there, and that is being supported by him. So he is not in favor of giving arguments. As you know very well, different arguments are sometimes being placed for the proof of God, but he is not in support of this, that one has to realize it. God is not being proved by arguments. It is a matter of realization. And here I am reminded of two verses of in this connection, one from that of Isopanishad and other is from that of Bhagavad Gita. And those verses, they also try to explain the same idea of in support of the Vedantic concept of God, and as it is being explained by Vivekananda. In Upanishad, in Isopanishad, if you come across the verse number 6, that jastu sarvani bhutani atman eva anupasyati sarva bhuteshu atmanam tato na vijupsate. This verse therefore gives an explanation that one who sees all beings in his own self and his own self in all beings, therefore he does not hate anybody. There is no question of hatred. That means he loves everybody. That means this is the realization that I am in others and others are also in me. This is love and this is the very nature of the reality. And that he therefore describes Satchit Ananda, Ananda is love, and this is love, extending oneself to others, as it is being said by Vivekananda, that is life, and contraction is death. And similarly, same idea is also expanded in Gita, that is in chapter 6 verse number 30 jo mam pasyanti sarvatra sarvatra mai pasyati pasyanti tasyaham nam pranasyami sachamena pranasyati. This is the same idea also being here. He who sees me in all beings and also sees all beings in me, and I am never without them, and also they are not without me. That means I and he, therefore they are one and same. That means that is therefore Brahmagyani, Atmagyani, who realizes that reality is in and through at the same time also, and transcend it. And that is therefore the idea of God by in Vedanta, which is being explained by Vivekananda. And in the Vedantic light, Vivekananda also describes the reality. I may quote, he means the God, the one who vibrates more quickly than mind, who attains to more speed than mind can ever do, whom even the gods reach not, nor thought grasps. He moves, everything moves. He in him all exist. He is moving and is immovable. He is near and also far. He is inside everything and also outside everything. And this is how he has tried to give the explanation of God, who is both immanent and transcendent, who is therefore finite and infinite, who is therefore with a name and forms, and at the same time also without name and forms beyond this. This is how he had to, and such idea is also well explained in our Upanishad. If you go through the verse number 4 and 5, you can get this idea also. Anejat ekam manasso javiyo nainam deva atmaman purvamasat tat dhavato nanyati tishtat tasmit apo matrishya dadati. This is the same idea which I've explained by Vivekananda. Similarly, in 5, tadijati tanijati taddure tadantike tadantarasya sarvasya tadu sarvasya bayata. This is how this idea of that he finite, infinite, or so to say your that he is immanent and transcendent, that is this God who is in and through at the same time also outside, beyond space and time, that is transcendental, that the real nature of the reality, and that therefore Vivekananda has pointed out. The most important theme of the Vedanta is oneness, as already I told you, or that is known as the differencelessness, and which is highlighted by Vivekananda, particularly in explaining his concept of universal religion, as well as also his practical Vedanta. And the Vedanta says, in the heart of things, there is unity, which already have been discussed. The difference is only appearance, and that's why it is unreal. The difference is only unreal, and he therefore says, let me quote him, if you go below the surface, you find that unity between man and man, between races and races, high and low, rich and poor, gods and men, and men and animals. If you go deep enough, all will seem as only vibrations of one. And he who has attained to this conception of oneness, he has no more delusion. And this is what he says. Therefore, if you go deep, means by realization, then you can find that all these particulars, therefore, were an appearance, that is therefore name and forms, but there is unity. So therefore, from this, we can go deep into it, and therefore, that is known as the realization of oneness. And therefore, he has traced the reality of everything to Lord, the center, the unity of everything, and that is Sachidananda, that is the eternal existence, eternal consciousness, and eternal love or bliss. This is how I can summarize that man is necessary. God is therefore being conceived by Vivekananda in the light of the understanding of Vedanta, as being visualized by Ramakrishna, that reality is both immanent and transcendent, That is, therefore, he is finite and infinite, and therefore he is named as absolute and God. And that's it is what is required. One has to realize it and going deep into it, and thereby all his delusions that will go away, and therefore he can find that is only one, and that one is the unity, that one is the oneness, that is the differencelessness, and that is the whole and core philosophy teachings of the Vedanta, which Vivekananda therefore explicates before the world. Now let me come to the concept of man, and here you will see that mostly we come across two different notions of God, man, and particularly in our Indian context, this concept of man is being well explained by the contemporary thinkers, as in a similar way, also Vivekananda has given the his explanation of man. With regard to man, we come across two such views, dualism and other is known as, that is the non-essentialism. Dualism, you know very well, that is body-mind complex, and therefore there is no scope for spiritualism, no scope for the eternalism, or so to say, no scope for the soul. And therefore that is body-mind complex, that is Western concept. And also the materialist thinkers, they do give Indian materialist like that of Charvaka, they also take man as a body-mind complex. And coming to that of non-essentialism like that of Buddhism, we know very well that everything is changing, so therefore, so nothing is real, and so also the man. And that is the concept we come across. But here we find Vivekananda analyzing Vedanta, he therefore says, man is the greatest being that is in the universe. Therefore, he has given much more importance to man, and this world of work, the best place in it, because only herein is the greatest and best chance for him to become perfect. So therefore, man is perfect, but he will be more perfect here in this empirical world by realizing his own nature, that is, he is infinite, he is also God, he is non different from that of God. This is the understanding of Vivekananda. Vivekananda has therefore countered both the views that I already have told you. One is the materialism, other is non essentialism. He has countered both, and he argues against this dualism. I may quote him: when the dualists claim that there is something which does not change, they are therefore perfectly right. But their analysis that it is an underlying something which is neither the body nor the mind, is something separate from both, is therefore wrong. So therefore, in this way, he has tried to criticize dualist, and also he has criticized the other theory, that non-essentialism of Buddhism. And he says, therefore, so far as the Buddhists say that the whole universe is a mass of change, they are perfectly right. But the reality is that there is both change and changelessness in the universe. It is not that man having three aspects, such as body, mind, and soul, are three separate existences. For this organism made of these three is really one. This is his concept of man, that body, mind, and soul, they are not separate from each other, and that is constitute one organism. They are not separate to each other, and therefore they constitute one. That is his concept of man, which differs from that of Western concept, that body mind complex is not. He therefore it is therefore the same thing which appears as the body, as the mind, and as the thing beyond mind and body, but it is not at all the same, all this. So therefore, here his concept of man, therefore both body, mind, and spirit being integrated, and therefore it constitutes one. And most often we are confined to this body and mind. We forget to realize the other one, And Vivekananda therefore has pointed out that man is having two aspects, though he has pointed out that both, all the three, they integrated and one, but he therefore points out, for the sake of understanding of both the common man, that man is considered of, is having two aspects, the finite and infinite. The finite aspect therefore refers to the physical aspect, which consists of body and mind, and the infinite aspect, which constitutes the real aspect, the true nature of man, that is therefore the soul. And therefore he points out, he who sees the body does not see the mind even. He who sees the mind does not see that which he calls the soul. And he who sees the soul, for him the body and mind have vanished. And that is how his conception of man, that man has to realize that he is not within this body and mind, and he is therefore something more, something beyond, and that beyond, when he realizes, that therefore he forgets other two, which are nothing but the name and forms, Namarupa, as you can say. And here, in Kathopanishad, as you know very well, this is a verse where the description is being there pertaining to man, and man is being compared with that of a ratha, that is chariot. It is being said, Atmanam rathinam vidhihi sariram ratham evato buddhim tu sarathim vidhi mana pragraham evacha. Therefore here that man is being compared to a chariot. Body is therefore taken as a chariot, mind is therefore taken as the rein, and buddhi is therefore the charioteer, and atma is therefore the occupying. This is therefore the lord of the chariot. In the similar vein, here he points out that man consists of both body, mind and soul, and soul therefore constitutes the real aspect of man, who is therefore can be said to be the, can in Kathopanishad language, that he is the lord of the chariot or lord of the body and mind. And with the similar the web and sea, that's a simile, which I already know very well, and has been explained by our friend Pramoda Babu. He has given this example also, the example or simile, just to explain that how these waves are nothing but the nama rupa, a name and forms, which therefore confined ourselves with this nama rupa, that is waves, but we fail to realize the sea, the true nature of the sea. Similarly, here we are confined within the body and mind, and therefore fail to realize the real nature, that is the soul. And here, the duality is to be replaced by the realization of oneness. That is to the call of the Vedanta, that one has to realize this oneness, and so that the duality that will vanish. And he therefore says, I may quote, there is no I nor you. It is all one. It is either all I or all you. But this idea of duality is entirely false. This can be realized by knowledge of discrimination. You may raise a question, how such a oneness can be realized? Unless you realize this oneness, which is the core philosophy and core teachings of Vedanta, so you cannot know Vedanta. You cannot realize, it is mere a textual study. But you cannot therefore have any such vision of realization of Vedantic philosophy. So therefore, the question may be raised, how can we realize it? And this realization requires the knowledge of discrimination. You have to discriminate. And this discrimination, which can be said to be that between the finite, between the real and unreal, that discrimination. And we most often therefore confine ourselves with body, mind, senses, ego, and that's why here we have to discriminate that these are not real. It is therefore the soul which is over and above all this, and this is not the whole. And this is how you have to realize, and this is known as knowledge of discrimination. When such discrimination comes to one point, this may be a question, and therefore he replies, it is I who am this universe as it now exists, a continuous mass of change. It is I who am beyond all changes, beyond all qualities. the eternally perfect, the eternally blessed. This is I, knowledge of I. I here refers to the soul, the Atma, that we have to realize that Atma, which is non-different from Paramatma, that is Brahman, that therefore is perfect, eternally perfect and eternally blessed, that one has to realize. The physical aspect, the body, mind, that undergoes change, you know very well, birth, death, janamami, punarapi janamam, punarapi maranam, punarapi janani, sayanam, sorry, Shankaracharya judgment, already you know. And therefore, here, birth and death, that occurs only to body, body and mind. But here, the soul, who is therefore beyond this, it does not have any birth and death because it is eternal. Swami is therefore points out, it is a nature that is changing. Nature here refers to these body, mind, sorry, the name and forms. So therefore, it is nature that is changing, not the soul of man. This never changes. Birth and death are the nature, are in nature, not in you. This is his own language. Man is deluded, taking the finite as real nature. Man is therefore deluded because he takes the finite as the real. Therefore, he confined himself within the body and mind, and also confined himself with all the name and forms which come across. And this is just like taking sun as moving and earth is static. This was the belief, and this is therefore like this. Here we take the unreal as real, and real is therefore is remain unknown and unknowable, and that is the whole cause of our ignorance, and therefore fail to realize ourselves, and therefore we are confined within this. But a realized man, a perfect man, therefore realizes it is as God himself. Already I have told you that he has to realize, he realizes that I am God. Vedantic epithets you know very well, Om Brahmasmi, Om Atma Brahma, So Aham, like this. So this is the realization that one has to realize that I am God, or God himself he has to realize. And again he also points out Vedanta, but it is a mistake to think that we are impure, that we are limited, that we are separate. The real man is the one unit existence. So this is our ignorance. This is our delusion. We are therefore weak. We are impure. We are limited. We are therefore finite. This is our delusion. This is our ignorance. But if we be realized, then therefore we have to realize that I am one. I am the unity. I am the unity existence. This is what the true nature of man. But the question is, how can we realize this? Realize it. This Vivekananda replies. I may quote him: "The pure and perfect being, the soul, is one wheel, and the external hallucination of body and mind is the other wheel." He has compared this in just like two wheels. The soul is one wheel, and the body and mind is being taken as another wheel, and these two wheels are therefore joined together, and they are joined together by a pole of karma. Knowledge is the axe which will cut the bond between the two. The two wheels therefore being separated by the axe of karma. And the wheel of soul will stop. Immediately the wheel of karma, soul will stop. But upon the other wheel, that of the body and mind, will be the momentum of past acts. So it will live for some time until that momentum of past work is exhausted. Until that momentum it worked away. And then body and mind fall and the soul becomes free. All his delusion and are passed away, and he is therefore called the living free. And this is just like taking a Jivan Mukta, or you know very well that your body and mind, that therefore they continue to live in body mind form so long his karmic impressions are there. But once he realizes that he is therefore not within the body and mind, he is spiritual, divine, and that divine realization therefore makes him free. And therefore, he becomes living free, jivan mukta. Then alone, a man And once he becomes free, once he becomes realized, when he become realizes this oneness, the reality, then alone the man loves everything. By realizing that the object of his love is not the unjust earthly objects, but it is the veritable God himself. So this is how he loves, and his love is universal, and therefore he extends himself to everything. So Vivekananda says, I may quote, and that the wife will therefore, with this realization, what happens? His quotation, I quote him, the wife will love the husband the more when he thinks that the husband is God himself. The husband will love the wife the more when he knows that wife is God himself. The mother will love the children more who thinks that the children are God himself. And that man will love his greatest enemy to that extent, the greatest enemy who knows that the very enemy is God himself. This is universal love. This is the realization of reality. And this is how all the differences, all the dualities, that vanishes. And therefore, one realizes the oneness, and therefore he extends himself to others. And that is the core philosophy and teaching of Vedanta. Such a man becomes a world mover, and whom his little self is dead, and God stands on its place. So therefore his little self, Jivatma, therefore that stops, and therefore he becomes one with the absolute, and therefore he becomes this world mover in that sense. The whole universe will become transfigured for him. The whole universe therefore become one. We are talking about Vasudeva Kutumbakam. This is not a only the words to be spoken, to be uttered. This is the realization that this, once one realizes this, and therefore he will become a world mover, and therefore he, the whole universe will become transformed for him, and it will become one family, and therefore he takes everybody as his brothers and sisters. That is Vasudeva Kutumbakam, and that is the Brahma realization, or the realization of self, realization of own divinity, is when realized that therefore man becomes so. Such a man therefore alone has the right to stand off and say, how beautiful this world is. So therefore he appreciates the world. This is the very beautiful creation of God. And therefore this is, and all his hallucinations, all his delusions, all his ignorances that vanishes, and therefore what he was taking as unreal, therefore he becomes very beautiful and very attractive for him. And what is needed is, it is to be realized and to be good, and all evils will therefore vanish for him. The universe will thus be changed. You will see human beings, refer to human beings. He will realize that you are all God. All animals and living beings are therefore manifestation of one living God. That therefore the realization. So therefore, not only the living, even the non-living objects, the objects of the empirical world, that will also become your attraction, because you are not only realizing that the creation refers to these living beings, being non-living beings, they are also come to this. And that is the universal brotherhood. That is the universal realization of oneness. You will realize that you will, this is the greatest gain of the individual, as well also the greatest gain to society. So therefore, this is the greatest gain on the individual organism, that he, once he realizes this, therefore he realizes his oneself. And at the same time, when he realizes this, this is the greatest gain to the society. And you know very well in Bhagavad Gita or in our ethics that one has to be good for himself, and also he has to be good for the society. And that is the our morality. That is the call of our Vedantic philosophy. And that is therefore, once he realizes this, therefore that will be reflected in his thought, action, feelings, everything. And therefore he takes everybody as his own. And therefore here, all differences will melt away, and therefore he will become asset to himself and also to the society. This is the real significance of the Upanishadic epithet, like Tattvamasi, or that thou art, then and then alone the whole creation, therefore, including the whole atmosphere of the world and the whole universe with suns and moons, the one voice will say, thou art that, thou art that. This is the whole teachings of Vedanta, and one has to realize this is the true meaning of man in the true sense of the term. But here one point I must point out, that though this aspect, the spiritual aspect, is highlighted by Vivekananda, but the physical aspect is not neglected or denied, because without this, this is also real, and this is not unreal, totally unreal, because already I have told you these are all names and forms, and therefore he has not denied it. Man cannot therefore exist in the disembodied form, and therefore he has also given importance to the body and mind also. This is the physical aspect, and the spiritual aspect is therefore the real aspect, therefore one has to realize. But because of ignorance, because of our illusion, we confine ourselves with this physical aspect or lower aspect, forget the other aspect, that therefore one has to realize. And that's why you might have heard Sariram Adhyam Kaladharma Sadhanam, that Sarira is therefore the basic thing, and without which therefore any sort of dharma sadhana, that therefore is impossible. And this is my submission. Now, I thank to all the organizers giving me the chance to speak a few words on this topic, that man and God and man, on Vivekananda's perspectives. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice lecture. You have said during the course of your lecture that Swami Vivekananda differing from Shankaracharya has taken the absolute to mean even the Ishvara and also the Jagat. He wanted that man should see God in everything. He has to see God in pleasure and pain, happiness and sorrow. So he has to see everything. So having said this, you have said a very important message by Swami Vivekananda, that if one cannot see God in everything, so he has asked people to see God in the best thing that they like. If they are able to see God in one thing, then they may think of seeing God in other things, and the process will go on. This is the great message that you have given following the philosophy of Swami Vivekananda. As regarding man, that you have very nicely pointed out, that man is the highest creation of God, and it is in this form that he has to realize himself and the reality of the world. But and he has very nicely said that man will see three distinct elements: body, mind, and soul. But they should not be taken differently. Rather, they should be taken as one integrated whole. We have to see a sort of unity in that. So that is the nice pointer from the philosophy of Swami Vivekananda. But one problem. Well, you have justified that at the end, but one problem that I saw in the middle of the lecture, that while making a distinction between the finite and the infinite, you have said body and the mind, mind as the finite and the soul as the infinite. Then you said that those who remain themselves to limit themselves to the body and the mind, they don't see the soul, and for those who see the soul, for them, the body and the mind vanishes. Here lies the problem with me. So, which you have to justify. Well, the later point, we have through the quotation, we have justified that even the seer of the soul, the realizer, the man who realizes the soul, must also have a realization that the body and the mind are also real. And body and the mind, they constitute a platform for the realization of the soul. So, overall, a very good lecture that we all have enjoyed. And at the last, we have said that his philosophy would bring in universal brotherhood, much needed for the society today. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for your nice lecture. Now I request Dr. Pragya Prakashini Das Kanungu to moderate the interaction session. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Rao. It was an absorbing talk. My regards to Dr. Bashant Kumar Das, sir. It was really illuminating. And we can, regarding the relation between man and God, we can quote Swami Vivekananda as saying, we can have no conception of God higher than man. So our God is man and man is God. It's an excerpt from Be One with God. There are a lot of questions I can see in the chat box. The first question is from Ratnakara Gajendra, sir. He asks, religion must be based on a metaphysics. Religion is a way of life. Vedanta distinguishes paramarthika satta, vyavaharika satta, and pratibhashika satta. What is the metaphysics behind Vivekananda's philosophy? Sir, hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay, sir.
Basanda, sir, has muted his microphone. He has to put it on.
Sir, please unmute yourself. He has left the meeting.
He has left the meeting. Well, we have to wait. Some network problem. Let us wait.
Sir, Pramod Kumar Das, sir, is there? You can respond to this question because it's on religion.
Yes, Pragya, you please repeat the question.
Hello.
No, Basanda, sir, is back. So.
Achha, okay.
Listen to me. My net is now coming down. Let me answer the question straight. First question is being asked to by Dr. Ratnakara Gajendra. I have heard the question. What is the metaphysical basis of Vivekananda? I think this is the question. But
yes.
Vivekananda, every philosophy has a metaphysics. Vivekananda, when developed his concept of philosophy of Vedanta, he has also this metaphysics. The metaphysics is this. That is, the reality is one and only one. And that, therefore, is in the absolute. And that's why he is known as a monist. At the same time, also, he has accepted that the differences or the dualities or the, so to say, the name and forms, the particulars, that is also there, that is being created by God. But that is not totally different that the absolute and the particulars, they are there or interrelated. This is, therefore, different forms. This is, therefore, the manifest form and the absolute, the unmanifest form. That is the whole thing. The whole Vedantic metaphysics is accepted by Vivekananda. Yes, next question is my submission. Yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Okay. Shall I
my net connectivity is now coming down. Please ask me the question set.
Okay. The next question is from Ratnakara Gajendra, sir. And the question is, again, Vivekananda equates, yes, God with Brahman. And Ramanuja also... Yes, sir?
Ah.
Yes, Ramanuja also equates God with Brahman. How do you explain this? So are you there?
It isn't audible.
He has already said there are network issues. So are you there?
Boston sir joined. Boston sir joined.
He's there, but he's not audible. Pramod sir, do you want to respond to this question?
He has put off the microphone. Boston sir has put off the microphone.
He has left.
No, he's there. Boston sir is there, but he has put off the microphone. That's the problem.
Yes, Pragya.
Yes.
The question is that I am just reading. Vivekananda equates God with Brahman, and Ramanuja also equates God with Brahman. How do you explain this? Yes. Vivekananda equates God with Brahman in the sense that Brahman and God are not two separate things. Brahman and God are one. One in the sense Brahman is understood as the unmanifest, and God is understood as the just like the waves. If the relation between God is the form of a Brahman. God is the form of a Brahman. Personal God, we can say personal God. God can be understood in the form of a religion. But Brahman is the unmanifest. In that sense, Vivekananda has understood it.
Hello.
Basant sir, kahantu sir.
ने सुबुचिता मु एक माने मोर हेड प्रॉब्लम होचे बोली मु माने एक्चुअली इते कट कर जा जाना
आपन आपन कहंत
आको कोन प्रश्न कोन थला
प्रश्न थला जे विवेकानंद गॉड विवेकानंद इक्वेट्स गॉड विथ ब्राह्मण रामानुज आल्सो इक्वेट्स गॉड विथ ब्राह्मण हाउ डू यू एक्सप्लेन दिस
अच्छा ठीक है Vivekananda therefore taken as he has accepted Brahman as absolute, and in that respect he has agreed with this Advaita Vedanta, and also he has taken the God as the reality. And in connection to Ramanuja, we find Ramanuja, for him God and Brahman, they are one and same. But his way of explanation is defined in the sense that he has taken the realization of God by means of bhakti. And the bhakti marga is therefore the method by the process or means by means of which one can realize the God. But here, Vivekananda has accepted it is the jnana, that is the discriminative knowledge by means of which one can realize that he is non-different from the absolute. This is my submission.
Yes, sir. And the next question is, sir. Sir, are you there?
He's there, madam. Put the question, madam. He's there.
Okay. The question is, Swami Vivekananda counters materialism and non-essentialism. What does he intend to establish? I don't think he is able to hear me.
Again, he is stuck. Again, connectivity issue. Again, connectivity issue. Let us wait for some time. Or you ask Pramod Das sir to respond, if he is comfortable with that.
Sir, can you respond?
Yes.
Okay.
Swami Vivekananda counters nothing. Swami Vivekananda counters nothing. Swami Vivekananda. By his philosophy, he accepts everything. He accepts the ocean and he accepts the waves. Therefore, his philosophy is a beautiful synthesis of materialism and spiritualism. Materialism is not out and out rejected by Swami Vivekananda. How can we reject materialism? No. Materialism is also accepted because we have to live through the materialism. We have to live through the diversities. Materialism cannot be not by any contemporary philosopher. Nobody has rejected materialism. Materialism is accepted. We accept our body, we accept our mind, but we have to uplift ourselves to the realm of spirituality. Spirituality, we can attain spirituality through our body and mind. True materialism. That is the message of Swami Vivekananda.
Okay. The next question is from Vijay Kumar Naik, sir.
Sorry, Pragya, I shall add one thing. Yes. Suppose there are three gunas, Sattva, Raja and Tama. Swami Vivekananda gives equal importance to Sattva and Raja. Raja symbolizes waves. Sattva symbolizes deep ocean. Swami Vivekananda has emphasized the status of Raja Guna, the power of the youth, Rajasic power. That is also equally important. If someone is established in sattvic knowledge, then that man is not complete. Sattva, Raja, both are important. The violent waves are equally important like the silent ocean. Only Vivekananda has given very much emphasis upon Raja Guna. Be dynamic, arise and awake, and stop not till the goal is reached. This is the voice of Vivekananda. He is accepting everything. We have to accept the diversities. We have to accept the opposites. We have to accept the antithesis. Then only we can reach the synthesis. Thank you.
Yes, his philosophy is all-inclusive.
Philosophy is all-inclusive.
Yes. And the question goes like this. It's a clarification he has mentioned. To know is to realize, and realization is possible through Viveka Jnana. Is it not a circular argument?
That should be circular. Your realization and your knowledge should go in a circle. There should not be any point, there should not be any gap between that. If there is any faction, any gap between your knowing and your realization, then there is neither your knowledge nor your realization. That should be circular. Whatever you know, that should be your realization. Whatever you realize, that should be your knowledge. That should be circular. It is not. It should not be understood like logical circular argument. That should be circular. Circular means there is no diversion. There is no point. There is no gap. There is no faction. What you know, you become that, and you should become that. Whatever you perceive, you become that. Whatever you think, you become that. Whatever you realize, you become that. Therefore, we say knowing by becoming. Our knowledge is our realization. Yes, that is circular. But being circular is not a fallacy. It is a blessing. We are suffering from not being circular. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. And the next question is from our dear Dr. Kalachandra Maharanan, sir. He asks, what's the stand of Swami Vivekananda on religion and reason when he says that religion is realization?
What is religion according to Swami Vivekananda? Vivekananda says that religion is the spiritual awakening in man. Man is very much concerned. Man is busy in his senses and understanding. Man should go beyond that. Man should be awakened of his spirituality. That is religion. And that spirit, that realization is common to all religions. That is the deep ocean. That is the silent ocean. That is the common factor of all institutional religions. What is that? That to go beyond the limitations of your senses and intellects. You have to be one with your spirit. And the second is realization. Yes, this realization is religion. If you realize this, that our factions, our differentiations, our diversities, our distinctions are only waves, but all these waves have been originated from that silent ocean. This realization is religion. If this realization is there, there is no religious conflict. There is no boundary. All gates are open for all. This is the message of universal religion. This is the religious realization. Thank you.
Yes, sir. It was a comprehensive answer. Thank you so much, sir. It was the last question, actually. Over to Rao, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Pragya Das Kanungo. Now, please propose the formal vote of thanks.
Okay, sir.
Over to Dr. Pragya.
Right. So it's now time to wind up the session by offering a formal vote of thanks. I'd like to take the opportunity to express my gratitude to our distinguished speakers, Dr. Basant Kumar Das sir and Pramod Kumar Das sir, who are so committed and dedicated to philosophy. My regards and gratitude to the members of the organizing committee for their unwavering determination and efforts, and the participants who didn't fail to be online with us till the end of the session. Thank you very much. Keep attending the sessions, and this is especially meant for the students. It's a request for the student participants to attend all the sessions. Thank you so much.
I thank Pragya for thanking all and for a beautiful moderation.
I'm a part of the family. No formalities, sir.
Okay.
I'm a part of the family.
That's your humility.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. So we now wind up the session. Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Now the meeting is closed.